He won't fail. No, he Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when strife. Christ alone. We'll be right back.
Father God, here in the power of Christ we stand. Christ and Christ alone is a strong foundation that we want to build our lives on. And so in the chaos of the storm, in the strong blowing of the winds around us that we can't control, we plant our feet one after the other on the strong foundation of the life, death, resurrection, and reign of the Lord Jesus. Amen. And so I pray that you would comfort those who are feeling tossed around this week, who don't feel like they can stand for much longer. You meet us in those places, in the valley and in the mountaintop. We survive them all, every season, every generation, because you are faithful, you are true, you are sure. So we build our lives on Christ and Christ alone. Hallelujah. We don't do it alone. We have a team, a choir around us, spurring us on to lift our eyes, to keep our feet planted on Jesus. And that choir joyfully and thankfully declared, amen. Amen. So good to be with you. Take a moment, say hi to the people around you. Welcome them to church. Meet someone new. If you're watching online, we're grateful that you're with us as well. Hope you're having a good weekend so far. Hang in there. We'll be back here in just a moment.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Growth Group Central 2022. I am Nick Jones, and I am here with my fantastic co-host, Jamie Jungi and Dan Jungi. Wait, Jungi? Are you guys married?
Well, yes, Nick, we are.
Okay, incredible. I'm sure you have some more great things to say, but I'm just so excited about G2s. Jamie, let's kick it off with you. Can you tell our beautiful viewers, what does G2 stand for?
Yes, Nick, I can. For any of you who aren't familiar with G2s, that's short for growth groups.
That's right, Jamie. I think it's important that everyone knows that the two signifies there are double G letters being represented, and the first one stands for growth.
Indeed, and thus the second stands for, you guessed it, groups.
So you have growth and groups make up the two G's. We don't call it 2Gs, we call it G2s. Thank you for cracking that riddle for us. Now, we have to ask ourselves the question then. We've got G2s, growth groups, if you will. What is the purpose? And for that, I think there's nobody better to explain it, certainly better than you, Dan, than our growth groups director, Wendy Holden. Now, did you guys know that we had a field? That's right, we have a field, and Wendy is on that field right now. Wendy, tell us, what are the purposes of G2?
Wait, it's Wendy at the field, or Wendy's down at the field?
It's Wendy at the field with Wendy on the field.
Oh.
Thanks, guys. First of all, let me tell you that I am so excited that we are in preseason for G2s. I mean, the hype, the energy is just great. People are gearing up to get back into that fun rhythm of gathering to study God's Word. It's just such good stuff. So, here at FBC, G2s are just, you know, one of the main play calls we have, if you will. Growth groups are the best way to connect with people and deepen your faith here at FBC. G2s get together once a week, and there are groups for all ages and stages of life. Our desire is for everyone that calls FBC their church home to be involved in a G2. I'm sending you all back to the studio for them to tell you how to get plugged in. Back to you, Nick.
Thanks, Wendy. You heard it here, folks. G2s, they're the place to be. Hey, Dan! Sorry, man, I'm just fired up. I got a little too excited. Would you tell us, when does the G2 season kick off?
Yes, G2 fall season kicks off the week of September 11th. So that means you have 3 weeks of this awesome preseason time to get ready. Sign up, start in the lobby today.
Today.
So if you're not in the group yet, you can get in one now.
Today.
That's right, Dan. And I'll add that if you're already connected in a group, you don't have to sign up. You're all set. You'll be hearing from your G2 leader to make plans for the season.
Jamie, you sound so dignified standing next to these two loudmouths over here. Man, guys, I guess we have just one question left to ask about this season. It's a pretty simple question, all right? Do you G2?
Do you G2?
Do you G2?
Last thing for today's kickoff. Our church is growing, and we are looking for more leaders to start new groups. We need new groups, new teams out on the field, and we need more leaders. It's easy. We'll give you all the training you need. If you think God may be calling you to lead a group, talk to a volunteer at the table in the lobby, or just call the church. We're gonna help everybody get ready for the G2 season. We've got defensive game plans. We've got offensive game plans. We've got strategies. We've got highlights from some of our veteran groups. It is going to be awesome.
I'm excited too. Don't forget to sign up for a group today, and we'll see you all next week for more G2 preseason excitement.
Yeah!
Thank you all for joining.
Good morning. Good to see you guys. I planned to say how excited I am about something else, but I just can't compete with that, can I? I mean, their enthusiasm is over the top, intentionally, right? You know what they're doing. They're having fun. So did you get the message, right? G2s, they start in a few weeks, but you might wonder, well, what are we doing between now and growth groups starting? So today starts 21 days to spiritual fitness. So I'm actually very excited about this. I'm excited about growth groups as well, but this is going to be amazing. Here's what we're going to do over the 21 days, guys. Get a booklet. Do your reading each day. It's going to walk you through the process every day of abiding in Christ, which is today's sermon subject, repentance, which is next week's sermon, and then taking steps of faith, which would be the third week's sermon. But you're going to do all three of those each day. It can take you as little as 5 minutes to do this. It can take you as long as you want, honestly. There's one verse of scripture each day printed in the booklet. There are prompts that just help you kind of like, well, what would that mean for me? And then you just write out some ideas. So why are we doing this? Let me just address something here, guys. We're doing this because sometimes people feel stalled in their spiritual life. Maybe they even feel disconnected from Jesus. And here's what we're going out on a biblical historical limb here and saying, if you will abide in Jesus, repent, and take steps of faith, you will jumpstart your walk of faith. You will feel more connected and close to Jesus. And even if you have a good walk with Jesus, you will go deeper. So we want everyone to do this. I know some people sometimes feel like some sort of a freedom to opt out of these kind of things. Some of you are, maybe you might be here your very first time today. And you're like, oh, I don't think I want to do that. It's the first time. I'm a new person. Wait, why would you do that? This is going to help you grow closer to Jesus. Some of you are like kids. And you're like, oh, that's for all the grown-ups. Kids, you can do this. This is not that complicated. Teenagers, I know you don't like to do what grown-ups say. That's fine. I'm not your parent. Do it. It'll be great. You'll connect, right? Some of you, you've been a Christian for like 50 years, and you're like, oh, that young pastor. Oh, I don't know if you say I'm a young pastor, but you say, oh, that pastor. I got my ways. I'm doing it my way. Listen, guys, this will change your life. So do it with us. Make sure you have a booklet. You can get them on, they're available on the website and the app as well. I highly recommend paper, because there's something that I think, I won't get into all the neuroscience, but I think there's good things about us writing with a pen or a pencil. Grab one, they're in the lobby, and start today. Today's the first day of this, okay? And it numbers them, it's all going to be great. Very excited about it. I'm just not going to yell at you about it, all right? Today's theme of abiding, the sermon today and this next song you're going to listen to, comes from John chapter 15. This is Jesus talking, and he's talking to us. So listen to what Jesus says to you, follower of Jesus. I am the vine. You, my followers, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing.
To see the goodness of your presence in our lives. Give us ears to hear your love singing over us. And we, your branches, ask that in your kindness you would help us to keep abiding in you for your glory and our good. Amen.
Well, good morning. I'm going to get the comic relief up and over at the beginning. I will start with, it's so good to see me. It's good to see you. You know, preaching for me is kind of a huge blessing and a great privilege. I remember as a little boy preaching to my dogs in the backyard. I had a little more hellfire and brimstone then in my preaching, but today I have the privilege of actually talking to the Church of Jesus Christ. And I have my best shirt on, so I'm feeling really good. So here we go. This morning, we're going to look at John 15, 1 through 11. And this is a passage that Jesus is speaking to the 11 disciples. One disciple called Judas Iscariot has already left the building. And many scholars believe that Jesus was talking while he was walking to the Garden of Gethsemane. All scholars agree that this was the night before his crucifixion. Back in the day when I was a little kid, I had the habit of memorizing scripture and got into my teens and my 20s and started memorizing a translation called the NIV 84 translation. And today that will be our translation since I'm speaking. But it is not the preferred translation of Foothills Bible Church, that is the ESV Bible. I believe this passage is as relevant today as it was when Jesus was sharing it with his disciples 2,000 years ago. So these are the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. That's worth saying again. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so that you prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is the word of God. Obviously, in this passage of Scripture, abiding is very important to Jesus. In 11 verses, he says abide in 10 times. And we'll unpack that a little bit. Also, he says, I am the true vine. It is the last of the 7 I am statements in the book of John. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. When Jesus says, I am, he is saying, I am God. When Jesus says, I am the true vine, and you are the branches, he is saying he is the only source to supply our every need. Jesus is the only source to supply our every need. He also says that the Father is the vine dresser who oversees everything in our spiritual life. And he will do the pruning in your life to make you more fruitful. I believe I could spend several hours, but Pastor Sean wouldn't let me, unpacking these 11 verses. But for our purposes this morning, I've narrowed the focus down to 3 questions. 1, what does abiding mean? What does abiding look like? And how can you abide? Abiding means for the Christian to dwell, to remain, to be present, to hang out with, to stay connected, to continue in your relationship throughout the day with Jesus, every day. I'd like to show you a comment from a modern day vine dresser.
You guys could see what? A lot of branches that are on the ground. Why? Because those are not going to bear fruit. And you know what? It's hard work because you've got to go in here. This one's not going to bear fruit. The Lord says every branch that does not bear fruit, he what? He takes off. He takes off. And what happens to them when they're taken off? They die and wither because they're not connected to the vine anymore. There's no going back. It's done. Okay? If we come closer here also, there's a reason why it needs light. The Lord said he is the light of the world. And look at this. Being the vine dresser, you've got to go in there by hand. Did you guys know that with all this technology in Silicon Valley here, we have not developed any machine yet that you can pull in here with a tractor that will sucker, that will do the thinning that needs to be done. It still needs to be done by hand in the 21st century.
Praise the Lord.
You know? And you know what? Being a vine dresser, it's not about being a machine. You've got to get in there. You've got to get your hands dirty. And our Father in heaven, Jesus is the vine. We are the branches, these green shoots. Okay? Look at how green and healthy they are. The Lord knows exactly what it is that we need.
Amen. As believers, we also need to remember that we have Christ's DNA, and as the true vine in our lives, from the very moment that we said yes to Jesus, the moment of salvation, Jesus says these words, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life." We are connected to the vine, never to be disconnected forever once we say yes to Jesus. The good news is, after receiving Jesus for salvation, we still keep receiving the DNA from the vine that continues throughout our lifetime. It will always be the Holy Spirit doing the work of the Spirit, not anything of the flesh. We will never produce any fruit on our own. Some of you that came in today, I'd like to back up a moment. Maybe the last thing you want to hear is what it means to abide in Christ. You may have had some significant losses in your life, death, divorce, difficult relationships, loss of a job, maybe dealing with cancer. You may be feeling some guilt or shame. Maybe even at times you don't feel like a Christian. You know, it may have been a week or a month or even a year for some of you. And you don't see how some of you may make it through another day. But I'm here to tell you that it is the best time in those times to abide in Christ. Scripture is clear: as believers, we will be pruned by the Father, which means we will face trials of many kinds. And I came across a verse that kind of brought some good news to that, and it's Philippians 1:6, and there's many other verses like it. It says, "Being confident of this, that he who has been doing a good work in you will carry it to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." Pastor Sean gave me a thought, and I like the thought. He says, God is in the long process of producing fruit in our lives. He's not in it for the short game. He's doing it like a vine, and he's pruning us to bear good fruit and bear much fruit. Our Father is patient and slow in the process of us becoming like his Son. Jesus says, you only need to abide in me. Draw near to me, and I will abide in you. I will draw near to you. Just this week, I asked my wife, Robin, a question, and that question was, how would you define abiding? And she gave me the answer, and I said, that's a pretty good answer. Hey, could you text me that? Well, she got on the phone, and she started talking. And so I got the audio text, and so I'm going to play it for you now.
Abiding in Christ is a thoughtful and intentional relationship with Him that results in joining Him in kingdom work on a daily, hourly basis.
Good answer. So abiding in Christ, when I was thinking about what it would look like, I thought about a good marriage. Not an okay marriage or a mediocre marriage, but you know, it's one of those marriages where, you know, it's kind of sappy and that couple kind of makes you sick. Rob and I are not there yet, but it's a good marriage. And it's a couple that regularly chats together in the morning, maybe even in the afternoon, evening. They're the kind of ones that leave these love notes, how much they love them in the lunch boxes and on the cabinet. And you know, when they're out of town, you find these little surprises all over the place. They make phone calls during the day, just not calling for anything, but you just say, I love you. And they share meals together. They take walks. They're the ones that hold their hands together. Mine gets sweaty, so it's not going to last long. They even take long vacations together. Instead of, I'm taking a vacation, you take a vacation, I'll see you when we get back. So they love being together. They want to hang out every day, and if they can, all day together. I believe abide is about a relationship. You know, my love language is acts of service. For me, it's all about doing. And Robin's love language is quality time, and it's all about abiding. You know, I'll do a boatload of chores. I'll run errands. I'll provide dinner. I won't cook dinner. I'll provide dinner. And that's a true story. And I'll do all these things, and I'll go to Robin. I'll say something like, look at what I did for you. So what do you got to say about that? And she says, thank you. Really? That's all you're going to say? Just thank you? Yep. Were you doing it for me, or were you doing it for us? I think it's a great comment. So Robin actually is the opposite. She wants to talk. And I even get nervous sometimes when she starts a sentence with, I've been thinking. You see, she wants this ongoing conversation on a daily basis. And if she had her way, she'd do it throughout the day. Why is that? So she wants us to be on the same page, to be thinking and pursuing the same things that are important in our lives. It's much like that with Jesus. It's not in our doing what God wants from us. It is in our abiding, our connecting with Him every day, all day. See, the Christian life is absolutely impossible apart from abiding in Christ. We get all of our spiritual strength and our spiritual life from Jesus. So what does abiding look like? It looks like some fruit that we'll talk about here in a second. But when I was thinking about this, I was thinking about when I hang out with my friends and when I hang out with Robin. You start talking like them. You start acting like them. And sometimes you even are thinking like them. And I have some Ken thoughts that I say on a regular basis around here and in my home and with my friends, and I probably either borrowed them from somebody, but it's kind of fun when I start hearing other people do my Kenisms. So one is, if you're a good friend of mine, and I even know your name, what I say is, hello, dog. How you doing, dog? And everybody's like, that doesn't sound right, but it is, because if you're a friend of mine, I'll call you dog. If you're not, I don't know you. So another one is, I like to say, true story. You know, at the end of a lot of things that I say, and they're like, well, really? I didn't think it was false. But for some reason, true story came out of that. When I have someone that gets in my path and they're a little cross-eyed, I say whack-a-doodle. Other people have caught that. Robin likes to say, that's right. So when I say, Jesus is Lord, that's right. I say, spaghetti for dinner, that's right. I'm in trouble, that's right. It's similar with Jesus, not the trouble part, but when we hang out with Christ, we become like him. And what happens is that we bear fruit, and the type of fruit we bear, one is Christ-likeness. You know, we put on Christ. You know, the thought sometimes is when people come to know Jesus, they think they're going to lose who they are. No, you're just a better who you are when you come to know Jesus. Because I'm still Kent when I came to know Jesus. I still have my personality. I still have my experiences. I still have my successes and my failures. Jesus just enhances what is already there when I desire to be like him. When I abide in him, I'm part of advancing the kingdom. See, that fruit is things like compassion and kindness and humility and patience, bearing with one another, forgiving one another, and loving like Jesus did. You know, I was thinking about all this fruit, and many times we don't think we have it, but we still go about our business of coming alongside people and loving people. And got a call from someone who was in the hospital, and the family wanted me to come, and the person was about to pass away, and they asked me if I would come, and they were in the ICU, and I jump in the car, and the first thing I do is I put it to some rock and roll music. Okay, judge me now, because we're going to move on. So I'm listening to some rock and roll music, because that was the way I just debrief. And so I'm listening to this rock and roll music, and I get to the parking lot and turn it off, and I'm walking down the hall to the ICU room, and then what happens is I'm about ready to turn the corner, and I'm humming that rock and roll song I was listening to. And the Holy Spirit hit me at that moment. This is abiding in Christ. When you're walking with Christ, you still do silly things. And the Holy Spirit told me in that moment, he didn't say, "Turn." No, he didn't do that. He just said, "In this, my spirit is, you have no business going into that room." Bummer, I drove all this way. I got to go back home. You know, so I turned around and I'm walking down the hall and I'm repenting that this is not about me. This is about a family. They need to experience the presence of God. And I'm bringing Kent, not the Holy Spirit that's in Kent, into that room. And I says, "I have no business doing your business." And at that moment, once again, the Holy Spirit says, "Now you have the business. If you thought you had business doing my business, you have no business. But since you know you don't have business, I'm going to give you the business." So I went in and had a great prayer time with the family. And the other aspect of abiding in Christ and we looking a little bit like Christ and having the fruit, it's called the fruit of the Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can give us that fruit. And it's the love and joy and peace and patience and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I don't have that without abiding in Christ. I get godly wisdom, the wisdom that's full of mercy and good fruit. I get godly thinking. You know, my thinking sometimes in our thinking are on my current problems, some money issues, paying the bills, trouble at work. Some people introduce themselves, give me their name, and I'm thinking about what's next. I don't even hear their name. You know, it's really sad. And it goes on. But God wants us to think this way. He says he wants us to think whatever's true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, he wants us to think that way. Jesus is saying these fruits can never be produced apart from Him. They can only be produced if we abide in Him. You know, the kicker to all of this is the fruit is not for you. Just think about it. Can a branch eat his own fruit? I don't think so. The fruit is hanging on the limbs for other people to see the fruit and want it. And they want to grab that fruit and they want to take a bite out of it. And I believe that when we possess these qualities, these characters of Christ that's in our lives, people want what we have, the fruit, that we're bearing much fruit, and we give it away. It's not for ours to keep. We still have it, but we give that fruit away. You cannot give away, however, what you do not have. Other side of benefits of abiding in Christ is answered prayer. Jesus says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given. There's a little picture I like for you to look at. It says, trust me, I have better for you. Someone gave it to me many years ago, and it's right in front of my desk that I can look at pretty much every day. Is that we want to hang on to this little it in our lives. And God has so much more He wants to give us when we abide in Him. It's not the health, wealth, prosperity gospel. It's a prayer that advances the kingdom of God and brings glory to God. That's the kind of prayer when we abide in Christ. There's evidence that we are followers of Christ when we abide. Verse 8 says, this is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. You know that it is God who is living inside of you when you're bearing that kind of fruit. I can't bear that fruit. I've tried to bear that fruit and it's exhausting. But when Jesus is bearing that fruit, wow, it's amazing. It's some of the worst times of my life I'm bearing that fruit because I'm abiding in Christ. And I'm making some good choices, bad choices. It's not based on that. It's based on, am I connected to Jesus on a daily, regular basis? We also abound in His love when we're abiding. We have abundant joy. He says, the reason I'm telling you all this, disciples, I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. I rarely dance, but I had a dancing moment. It's usually special occasions. But there was one day in my office, I was having an abiding in Christ moment. And suddenly, out of nowhere, I felt like dancing. No music, but I started dancing with my clothes on, just so you know. Not like David. Because you know why? I was supercharged with enthusiasm for Jesus. The good news about that dance is only God saw it, to my knowledge, and maybe a few angels. And He thought it was acceptable. How can you abide? You know, first of all, there's no formula to how to abide, but I have some thoughts on how you abide. I'll tell you how I abide is I am consistently in the Word of God. I read the Bible, but I not only read it, I study the Word. But it doesn't stop there, at least for me. I meditate on the Word of God. It's not like I go, I don't do that. I literally think about how this is going to impact my life. I memorize the Word because I don't always have the Word of God with me. Sometimes I don't even have my phone, which has the Word of God in it. But I memorize the Word. I hide it in my heart. And I pray the Word. And all of that means is, something like I'm reading about forgiveness. And I read that, you know, Jesus has forgiven me completely. And He has forgiven me quickly. And so I bring that into my life and I said, is there someone I need to do that for? Is someone I need to go and ask forgiveness for what I've done to them? That is praying the Word, and then I get a conviction of the Holy Spirit. Yes, that's what you should do. Or maybe you don't need to do that. You know, idea is when I abide is that I remember. It's very important to remember that you're a child of God. The moment you said yes to Jesus, and you are now a permanent part of the true vine, Jesus, you will never lose that salvation, but also you will never lose that fellowship with God, because it's not based on performance. It's not based on your failures. It's based on His love, His mercy, and His grace for you. I love thinking about Scripture when it says that God has lavished His grace, and God has lavished His mercy, and He's lavished His love, and lavished in the English language, by the way, I looked it up in the English dictionary, means downpour. And when I think of downpour, I usually think of Winnie the Pooh and Eeyore. And Eeyore has that little cloud over his head. And over his head is sometimes rain coming down. And he always go, oh, bother, because he's in so much trouble. And instead of, oh, bother, he looks up, and the rain is God's love. That's a downpour. The rain is God's mercy, a downpour. The rain that's coming down is God's love. And the good news of that, it never stops. It's ongoing. The moment you say yes to Jesus is for all eternity. What? Yeah, it's not based on me being a good guy. It's based on what Jesus did for me. And when I'm abounding in Jesus, I see it on a pretty regular basis. You know, Jesus wants us to hang out with Him. And he wants more than just Sunday morning or special occasion. He wants it every day. Jesus says, abide in me, that is, just hang out with me. And when you go about your day, I want to hang out with you. When you go to work, when you go home, when you go to sleep, when you can't sleep, that's me. In fact, when I can't sleep, I wake up and now He puts somebody on my heart, now I'm praying for them, and somebody else comes to mind, I'm praying for them, and then I was like, God, really? I really need to get some sleep. And He is saying, abide in me, even when you can't sleep, when you're hiking, when you're biking, when you're at a ball game. You know, I just want to hang out with you. I want you to ask me for help when you get some bad news, when you're making a tough decision and you don't know what to do. When you abide in me, this has been my experience throughout my ministry life and even before my ministry life, and here in the future, if I'm not in ministry, it doesn't matter. He says, what I want you to do is I want you to feel me more. I want you to see me more. I want you to hear me more. I want to guide you more. I'm going to give you more because why? You're hanging out with me. Years ago, I became the care pastor. I was a youth pastor for 4 years and then care pastor here at Foothills for 28 years now. And one day, about 2 weeks into the ministry, I experienced one ICU visit with an infant, and had all the tubes and all that, and the mom asked me to pray for that infant, and I didn't know the outcome of that, but it actually ended up pretty well. Another week goes by. It's very late at night. I get a call, and this family wants me to come to the hospital, and it's extremely late at night, and we're talking midnight, 1 or 2 in the morning, and so I'm there with the family, and the baby didn't make it, and they asked me to hold the baby and bless the baby. And I stay with the thought that I'm 2 weeks on the job. And I left that room, and I was talking to God, abiding with God, connecting with God. And I said, Lord, I have no business doing this. I can't do this. And I said, I need a sign, and I need it right now. And what happened that night kept me in the ministry now for 28 years. You see, I'm talking to God, and I'm getting ready to get on C-470 from Littleton Hospital. And I missed a turn and I hit a light. It's a stoplight. And as I'm at this stoplight, I look right when I said right now. And I looked to my left and it was kind of a nice car. And there was a little gal, all of maybe 2 or 3 years old, standing up in the back seat. And there was a little gal that had just passed away. And here I am looking at a little gal just moments later. And she looks at me in the eye and gives me a wave. And my first thought was, why are you not in a car seat? 100,000%. Then I reversed a little bit, rethought about it, and it was God saying, I got this. You cannot do this job apart from me. And so that's why I've been here for a very long time, because it's me abiding in Christ. Don't do it perfectly. Have some bad days. But on a consistent basis, I do okay of abiding in Christ. He wants it every day, throughout the day. You know, I stole a little illustration from Tony Evans. It goes like this. Mercury in our solar system is always hot because it's closer or close to the sun. So 24 hours a day, Mercury is hot. Pluto is always cold because it is so far away from the sun. Pluto is always cold. Mercury is always hot because Pluto stays far away from the sun, and all of them are planets. There's some controversy on Pluto. But they don't share the same amount of heat. Now, Earth is hot and cold because it's seasonal. And the reason it's seasonal is that it rotates. See, that's the same way with some Christians, is they rotate between hot and cold. So if you want to experience the sun, the S-O-N, consistently, then leave Pluto behind because it's always cold. But you've got to leave Earth behind also, because it's a seasonal Christian. If you want to be a Mercury Christian and get the heat of the sun, S-O-N, 24 hours a day, abide in me. And let my word abide in you, and you will bear much fruit. I would like to end with a tweak of a quote from Ferris Bueller. And it's a tweak, so it's not an identical quote. Life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and abide in Christ, you might miss it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are humbled to come before your throne. We thank you that we can come boldly before your throne, not because we're good people, but because of what your son Jesus did for us. Not only did he die and was resurrected, but he went through the heavens and he sits at the right hand of you, interceding on our behalf. Therefore, we can come with our request, and you will give us your grace and your mercy in our time of need. So, Lord, I ask for everyone that has heard this message today, that they would hang out with you, that they would be in your word, they would think about ways to put the word into action in their everyday life. And I thank you for the privilege that we have to serve you and do your kingdom work and to bring you glory with our lives. Thank you for what you're going to do in and through us this week as we abide in you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Foothills, as we respond to that, I'm going to invite you to stand and we're going to pray in these beautiful old words together.
Falls the even tide. The
it's hard to get the message, right? Or miss the message that we want you to abide in Jesus this week and the next 21 days. Man, it's going to be amazing for you. Because I talk to lots of people about church and things, and here's the conversation that I have a lot with people. Well, we went to that church and we didn't really like the music. And people tell me that all the time. It's no surprise, is it? No. Or they'll say, well, we went to this church and, you know, we really didn't like the preacher. And I'm like, yeah, I get it. You know, a lot of people don't like me. That's fine. Man, church is not like evaluating what people do on the platform. Living like as a body of Christ, as the family of God, is all of us being these branches that are all connected to Jesus. We're abiding in him. And man, we just like love each other. It's okay to not like the music and the preaching. That's fine. We don't have to be your favorite, I guess, is what I'm saying. But man, if we're abiding in Jesus, that is what it is all about. I'm praying for you guys. I'm so excited for the next 21 days in all of our lives. I don't know if I mentioned it. I got a head start on you. I started this a few days early, and I just want to say it's been amazing. It's so good. I'm so excited for you to be jumping in. Obviously, you got the G2s you can sign up for out in the lobby. We're finishing up our fiscal year. We've got 2 more weeks, and then we close our books for this year. We're trying to finish on budget, and if you'd like to be a part of helping jump in on that, you can give in the giving box, you can give online, you can give through the app, and we just ask you to pray about jumping in and being a part of what we're doing financially as part of also just being a part of our church family. So for the benediction, you guys, this is a second service special you're going to get right now. We didn't give this to the first service, all right? You guys are special. Dan, I heard this is a very special day for you. What is that? Like, what's going on in your life today?
It's my 66th week at Foothill. No, I'm kidding. It's my 18-year anniversary today.
18-year anniversary today for Dan.
I was married at 10.
Yeah. Allison here is in here somewhere, his wife, his beautiful wife.
Yes, I'm very thankful for Allie and 18 years with my best friend.
So way to go, man.
I'm super excited.
Way to go.
A little birdie told me it's also a significant day for you.
That is a significant day for me. It is also my wedding anniversary today. We got double wedding anniversaries. So 23 years for us. Happy anniversary, Cassie. I love you. So I don't know. I bet if we went to like a restaurant and we told them that, then maybe they give us like a free lunch or something.
We'd
at least
get some free bread.
They'd probably say... Oh, goodness. All right. Let me give you a benediction as we're leaving, all right? So, like, let's get the mindset here. As God's children, right? As his branches who are connected to him with his DNA flowing into you from him, hear these words now. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. God bless.